Python contributor and creator of wallpapers. Thank you.
Hello everyone. I'm super excited to be here. So today I'm going to talk about async.io, one of the most popular library models that comes with Python 3.4. Yeah, I know. Yesterday we already had two talks that cover the same theme, but now I'm going to focus on the async.io library itself. I am not going to talk about Tornado, Twisted Metrics, Gvan. So I'm going to talk how to program asynchronously, how to deal with many IO requests in a short time with async.io library modules. I just said that this async.io came with Python 3.4, and I know that most people don't use Python 3 in the real world yet. I mean, yesterday I talked to some people when I said you still get stuck with Python 2. They all laugh at me. So, but bear with me, because the async.io still can be used with Python 2. It just you have to use differently. You don't use the special syntax yield form. I'm going to show you how to do that with Python 2. But before that, I'm going to explain something more important than the technical how-to. It's the fundamental idea behind async.io. And I'm going to explain it in a different way than they did yesterday. So let me convince you that learning async.io will be a good investment for you, because if you attended the talk yesterday about the transfer pipelines in the DreamWorks, that's a cool software, and you can achieve the same thing with async.io. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Fajar Skycock, and I know by the end of this talk you wouldn't remember this name. So just call me Sky, please. Don't be shy. You can approach me. I'm a friendly person, and I live in Jakarta. I hail from Jakarta to come here, so I'm very excited to be here. I work in KMK Online, the company that is responsible for Liputan 6. Is one of the biggest news websites in Indonesia. And in my spare time, I'm a regular contributor of Python Core, and I found it as a rewarding experience. But I'm not a core developer yet. So I used to contribute to Django, Ruby Core, but time has become expensive for me now. And other than that, I'm a sole developer of wallpapers. It's my first open source project that's built by Pythons, and it's used by many people around the world. Basically, it's a wallpapers. It enables you to have different wallpapers for different workspaces on Unix desktops. Back then, like many years ago, I used GNOME, and I kinda envy of KDE desktop that can have different wallpapers for different workspaces. So I tried to enable it on GNOME by writing wallpapers. Okay, so let's get down to business. But first, if you want to contact me, you can use the first email if you want to work with me in Jakarta. Don't worry, it's a nice place. And use the second email for anything if you want to discuss the weather with me. Okay? So, let's talk about the problem which async.io is designed to solve. The problem here is that I/O is slow. Okay, I know everyone knows that. But the thing is, you cannot escape I/O. I/O is everywhere. As a Python programmer, you would have to deal with I/O in one and another way. You may have to download the images from Amazon Bucket. You may have to request data from database. You may have to communicate with another Python process. So I/O is everywhere. Unless, of course, if you are the kind of programmers who writes an applications which its purpose is to find the largest prime number under 2 billions, then you may you don't need to care about I/O. The thing is, as a Python programmers, you have to deal with many I/O requests in a short time. Otherwise, you will you will not get efficient program. So let's we go to the real world applications. So this is like a basic of web crawler. So recently I watched a YouTube video. I watched an advertisement on YouTube about a website that can help you find the cheapest price for ticket flights, flight tickets, and hotel rooms. And they definitely use the web crawler. So I mean that people build business by writing web crawler. So here we build something similar. We create an application to get the web pages from three news websites, Spiegel, Guardian, and Le Monde. And as you can see here, the line that was highlighted with blue color is an I/O blocking function. It's going to get the web page, and it faithfully does until it gets the web page or it gets killed by signal or timeout or an exception. And that is the problem. As you can see here, I download the web pages sequentially. So if you're going to build a business by writing this kind of code, you're going to be a bankrupt. If you are an employee, you're going to get fired by writing this code. So before I'm going to explain you how to deal with this, how to improve this code, let's model this kind of solving problem. So, and we would get this graph. So here, the arrow represents the linear time. So the color boxes represent the time when we get the real data, when we get the real bytes from the server. And so in the blue color box, represent the time when we get the real data from the Spiegel, and the yellow is for Guardian, and the red is for Le Monde. And the gap within the color boxes represent the time when we sit idly, when we wait for the next chunk date of data. So as you can see here, the server doesn't send you the web page in one block data. They send you data chunk by chunk. And between those chunks, you will have to wait. And as you can see here, we have a long gap. And those gaps represent the time we waste. In business, time is money. So when you look at that gap, you can see the gap is the money that you lose. That's why I said that if you wrote this kind of codes, you're going to lose money. So I think I can help you to reduce the money that you lose. Okay? So, but before we solve that using async I/O, I'm going to explain to you how to solve it with threading. The reason why I'm explaining how to solve this problem with threading is because when we compare both approaches, you will understand async I/O better and faster. And aside, there's a time when async I/O falls short and threading can trump. If you attended the talk yesterday about the transfer pipelines in DreamWork, there's a situation when async I/O cannot help you, such as like a listing directories, getting the m time attributes of the files. So here, when we want to solve the problem of dealing with many I/O requests in a short time, so the common pattern is you create its threads for dealing with for one I/O operations. So here, because we have to download the three web pages from three news websites. We have to download the web pages from three news websites. So we have three IO operations. So we create three separate threads. So one thread for each website. So because this blue color box represents the thread, so we have four threads. The upper box represents the main thread. Now, if we model this kind of solving problem, we would this kind of graph. So here, we as each IO operations gets its own dedicated line. So for IO operations of downloading the web page from Spiegel, gets its own dedicated line. So when we get blocked while downloading the web page from Spiegel, while we are waiting the next chunk of data from Spiegel, the other IO operations can still run. They don't have to wait for us. So as you can see here, while we get blocked on for the first time while downloading the web the next chunk of data from Spiegel, the other threads can still get the data from Guardian and add another thread for Lemon. And now here, how we are going to solve this problem with async IO. So in async IO, you only need one thread. So here we have one blue box. That is the only thread you need. So here, these coroutines you see are comparable to the threads that you saw just now. So because we have the three IO operations, so the common pattern is to create three coroutines. Each coroutine is responsible for downloading the web page from one news website. But we have something different here. There's an event loop. So here, the event loop is like an intelligent machine that runs and executes the coroutines. So in async IO code, you don't execute the coroutines directly, just the way you do with threading. But you have to put this coroutine inside the event loop, and you start the event loop. So in this case, you can say that event loop is something like the operating system. In the threading case, it's the schedule, the task between them, and the schedule, the priority between them. But please don't take that analogy too far, because they are kind of different. So if we model this way of solving the problem, we would get this graph. So here, it's same as naive model. The async IO all the IO operations share one line. But we have something different here. The color boxes are intertwined to each other. So here, we get the data next chunk of data from Spiegel, then we jump to the IO operation of downloading the web page from Guardian, then we jump to the Spiegel again, then we jump to Lemon, jump to the Spiegel, and so on. We do it so to avoid the IO blocking time. So when we sense that for these IO operations we will get blocked, we switch to another IO operations. That way we can reduce the gap. We will still get the gap between the color boxes in async IO code. It's just that we would have the shorter gaps. It means in business we lose lesser money. So here, if you could only remember one slide from this talk, let this one be. Everything is derived from here. Okay? So let's get down to the technical detail. So the common pattern, if you are dealing with many IO requests with threading, so you create as many threads you need, and you create a function that inside these functions you are going to execute the IO blocking functions. Then you feed this function to the threads, then later you start the threads, so on. So the lines that were highlighted with green color is the line where you create the threads, and the lines that was highlighted with blue colors represents the IO blocking functions. Now, technically speaking, print is a IO function, but for now you can ignore it. Now, for this sleep delay, you can see it as a representative of the I/O blocking functions that you need in your daily life as a Python programmer. It means like OS.system, or in the previous example, URL lib request and the subprocess popen, then later you communicate with this popen objects. Anything that you're going to get an IO and going to get an IO request and blocks, this is it. So you put this IO blocking function inside the function, then you feed to the threads. So for the technical detail with async IO code, they are kind of different. So here, instead of creating function that is going to execute the IO blocking functions, you're going to create a coroutine. Basically, it's just a function that you decorate with a coroutine decorator, and inside this coroutine, you execute the IO functions with a special syntax yield from. But this yield forms is only valid if you use the async IO with Python 3.3 and Python 3.4. So it is true that Python 3.4 async IO comes with Python 3.4 in the standard library. But if you use Python 3.3, you can download the async IO from third-party provider, but they don't call it the async IO anymore, they call it Tulip. If you use Python 2.7, because the Python 2.7 doesn't support yield from, they change the way you interact with async IO. Later I'll show you it. You can download the async IO from the third-party provider if you use Python 2.7, but they don't call it async IO, they call it Trolius. Okay, let's get back to the technical detail. So you're going to execute this IO functions inside the coroutine with the special syntax yield from. Then later, these coroutines, you convert it to the task, you wrap it to the task. Then later you run the event loop. Remember, I said everything is executed inside the event loop. Here, the loop object is the event loop. So now, if you take notice, there's something different here. Here we use async IO sleep, but in the previous example, we use time.sleep. Some of you may ask why we don't execute time.sleep inside the coroutine. Why must we use the async IO.sleep? And so there's two questions. Why do we need to use yield from, and why do we need to use async IO.sleep instead of time.sleep? So I'm going to explain the latter question first. Let's get back to the fundamental idea behind async IO. Remember when I show you this graph? So in async IO code, everything happens in one thread. So it means if you're going to execute a function that is going to block, so everything is going to get blocked. Every other coroutines will get blocked and the event loop will freeze. So that's why you have to avoid the normal IO blocking function when you write the async IO code. So it means when you are going to write async IO code, you cannot use the normal IO blocking function anymore. So it means if you're going to solve the earlier problem, you cannot use the URL lib request URL open to get the web page from the news websites if you are going to solve the problem with async IO code, because it will defeat the purpose of async IO. So you need something different here. Now here we have the async IO compatible functions. This function is going to execute the IO computations, and it will not block. So here it will communicate with event loop. When it sends, it will get blocked. It will tell the event loop that, hey, I'm going to get blocks. Why don't you switch to your attention to some other coroutine. So for all the I/O blocking function that you need in your daily life as Python programmer, async I/O library modules already provided the replacements. If it doesn't, most likely is the third party provider already provided it. In the case of AIO HTTP, this AIO HTTP is like a comparable to the URL lib request. Now, so the basic idea, if you are going to write async IO code with async IO library modules, you execute this IO functions, whether it's going to get the web page from the server, whether it's get the data from database, whether it's to get the results from the external process inside the coroutine, but you don't use the blocking function anymore. You use the async IO compatible function, and you execute it with the special syntax yield from, then you get the result, and you do, and everything else is the same. So no more blocking function in your async IO code. So when you're going to execute the IO function, ask yourself, is this going to block? If it is yes, find the replacement. Most likely they are already replacements. So if we are going to solve the earlier problem with async IO, here is how we do it. You get the request object with the special syntax yield from. This response object is the object which you can inspect the final URL and so on. Then later you get the web page itself by calling yield from response read. This way, when you download the web page and you get blocked like 5 times, this yield from response read will tell the event loop to switch the attentions for like 5 times, so it will not get blocked. It will intertwine with each other the coroutines. So now I'm going to answer the first questions. Why do we need to use yield from? But let me get back to the story of yield without from and the idea behind generator. So in Python land, there are two kind of functions. The first one is the function of nothing or all. You're going to get all the results or nothing at all. It's either 0 or 1. It's either black or white. There's no gradient. There's no gray color. Either you get the full result or you don't. That's what we call the normal traditional IO blocking functions. Either you get nothing at all or you get the full web page. But there's another kind of function which is is a little bit special. We call it generator. These functions let you to consume a part of the result. So you don't have to consume all the results. You can consume half of the results and stop it, and you can do other things first, maybe like printing hello world 500 times, then you can resume the remaining part of the results. So here we can see that special function, we call it generator, that gen. All the results is 1 and 2, but we let the caller to consume a part of it. So we consume the caller of this, the call of this generator, consume it by calling next, and we get the part of the results 1, and after that we can stop it, or we can do other things first before we resume the other half of result by calling next again. When you write the async IO code, you use the async IO compatible functions. Imagine that async IO compatible functions is defined like this. So you get some data, you get the chunk of data, or you get the 10 kilobytes, then you give this part of the results to the caller. Then you get the data more, get the part of the result, you send it back. So the caller can do other things between the results between the full result of this async IO compatible functions. Now, so who is the caller of this async IO compatible functions? It's our coroutines. Technically speaking, the async IO compatible function is a coroutine itself, but for now we differentiate them to make it easier for you to understand. So inside the inside our coroutines that consume this async IO compatible functions, this async IO compatible function is like a async IO sleep. Now we get the part of the results by calling next, but inside this coroutine we cannot do something useful between the part of the result. I mean, so here there's nothing useful I can do between the part of the result, between the part of the web page. If I want to get the full web page so I can continue to do something useful, so inside the coroutines we want to get the full result. We don't care the part of the results. But while the coroutine doesn't care the part of the results, the event loop needs it. Why does the event loop needs the part of the result? Because the event loop wants to do something useful between the part of the results, between the chunk of data of the web page. What is that something useful? It's to execute another coroutines. So that's why we get this intertwined color boxes. That's the fundamental idea behind why we use the yield from and async IO compatible functions. We don't send the full result. We send the results part by part. So between this part of the results, we can do something else, like executing another coroutines that send the results part by part itself. So, but it doesn't answer why we must use yield from, because right now we just use yield. Now to understand why we use yield from instead of yield, you can see here this in the coroutines, we get this kind of boilerplate. So it's kind of wasteful of space inside our coroutine. So the non-booking functions send the part of the results. In our coroutine, we pass it back to the event loop, and the event loop may want to execute another coroutines, and that coroutines will consume another async IO compatible function. That async IO compatible function will send a part of the result of it. We have too much bureaucracy here. Our coroutines becomes obstacle of efficiency. So instead of becoming a middleman, why don't we let the non-blocking function communicate directly to the event loop? So here, that's why we use yield from. So I don't care about the part of the results. Why don't you communicate directly to the event loop? Once you get the full results, then tell me. Now, so if we will get this graph, if we use the yield from, so no more middleman, the non-blocking function can communicate directly to the event loop. Then event loop will do something useful between the part of the result. Now here's the thing. There's a time when asynchronous code cannot be there's a time when synchronous code cannot be met asynchronous. There is a time when async IO cannot help you. You may have IO blocking functions that doesn't have the async IO compatible version of it. In that case, you may execute it in the separate thread. So async IO modules provides you a convenient function to execute this IO blocking function, so it will not freeze the event loop. So here we use the IO blocking function, the URL lib request URL open and the request objects, and later we yield from the object. Then you can do something useful. So now I'm going to show you the final code of the downloader. So here, now you can see it right in the back. Okay, so in the trading, for each news website, you're going to create a separate thread. Then later you feed this function to the thread. Inside these functions, you're going to execute the traditional I/O blocking function, and it will get blocked. But it's okay because it get blocked in the thread, and that's not our concern anymore. That's a operating system concern. So here we start the thread. Then later we wait for them to finish. Now for the async I/O, you get this coroutine. Inside this coroutine, you execute the I/O functions. This is kind of special. This is like it will send the results part by part. But we don't care. We just want to get the full results. So that's why we use yield from. We tell the AIO HTTP request to send the part of the results to the event loop. Then once you get the full results, you go down one line. Here we need to get the full result before we can assign it to the body. But the response rate will send the results part by part. But we don't care inside the coroutine, so we use yield from to tell the response rate. Why don't you communicate with the event loop directly? After we get the full result, then we can do something interesting with body. You know, something interesting such as printing to the ST out. Then you get the event loop object. This is the event. This is the intelligent machine that I'm talking about. It's the one that's going to execute the coroutines. But before the coroutines gets executed, we need to convert it to the task. So here we convert it to the task, this coroutine. Once we got the task, we run the event loop to tell this event loop to execute this task. This async I/O wait is something like thread join. You want to wait the task to be finished, then you close the event loop. So if we now, this is the client type of async I/O code. It's like a web crawler. It's kind of interesting, but I'm going to explain to you how to write the server type of code using async I/O. But first, why don't we run it? You know, because I saw a talk yesterday. They execute the code online. So here. So here, if we run it. Oh, I don't have the internet connection. Never mind. We just continue to the server. Here, imagine that you have a process. Here we just printing the Mahatma Gandhi's quote to the STD out, and we will simulate the I/O blocking time with the sleep 3 seconds. So we are going to write the caching server that will get the result of the Mahatma Gandhi's quote program. So there's nothing special here. It's just going to print Mahatma Gandhi's quote randomly after 3 seconds to the STD out. And so if we're going to solve this problem with threading, this is how we do it. So I'm going to create the Unix server with the Unix file socket. So I create the Unix servers that you created as a subclass of the threading mixin and the socket Unix stream server. Then you tell this class we are going to use this file, and there's a proxy server. In this proxy server, you can imagine it's like a protocol. So this is our I/O blocking functions, the traditional I/O blocking functions, which will get blocked if you execute it. So here, this is the handle. Every client is going to get executed inside here. So this is the I/O blocking functions. Then you send the result. Now, let's simulate the server. These many clients, it just to simulate like a simultaneous clients, simultaneous access to the server. So there's like a 4 clients that's going to access the server. They want to get the Mahatma Gandhi squad. Okay, so with threading, we can solve this problem. We don't need 12 seconds to get the whole Mahatma Gandhi squads. We only need like a 3 or 4 seconds. That's because the I/O blocking functions, this I/O blocking function, this one gets executed inside a thread, inside the separate threads. So it's okay to execute the I/O, the traditional I/O blocking function inside thread. So that's the idea behind solving many I/O requests in a short time with threading. So let's take a look at how we handle this with async I/O. And we will get something like this. First, you get the event loop. Then the event loop has like a convenient methods of creating many kind of servers that you're going to need. For example, like a Unix server, TCP server, datagram server. So, other than the necessary details that the server needs, such as like the file that you're going to use a socket, we're going to send like a protocol. This is the protocol. It's defined how you are going to have a connection with the client. So here we have this connection map. It will get executed when there's a new connection from client. And here we have this coroutine. This is we use the yield from, we execute this async IO create subprocess exec. Then we use yield from to get the status of the process. And this inside this connection made. Yeah, this is the coroutine. We convert this coroutine to the task. Then it will get executed when there's a client accessing our server. So this is when it gets executed. So now we have something different here, the transport. The transports is the ones that represents the connection, that represents the I/O computations. It represents our async I/O server and the client. So with this transport, you can send, you can read, and for certain protocols such as like if you are going to communicate with the external process, this transport can give you the PID, the PID. But for the TCP, of course, it cannot give you the PID because its PID is specific to the process communication protocol. So here, if we are going to execute it, now, this is our 4 clients accessing the server. 1, 2, 3. Now, so we will not get blocked. Nah, here the idea is, if you are going to write a server using async.io, you create the kind of server you want to use, such as Unix server or TCP server. Tell them what kind of protocol you want to use. But this is not the only way. You can send a normal coroutine with accept the two arguments. These two arguments represents the reader and writer. But for this case, we use the full-blown protocol. It has a connection made, the data receive, and the connection loss. But I'm not interested in the data receive and connection loss event. I'm just interested in the connection made event. So here, we execute this like a communicating to the external process, the process of producing the Mahatma Gandhi squad, and we convert it to the task. Then you execute it with the, then you run the server. And to handle the error code, to handle the error case in the async.io is kind of different. In the threading, you can use the normal. You can use the normal exception. You just use try catch. But inside the async.io, when we get the task, this is like a future. There's nothing interesting here. When we get this task object, you cannot get the results. You will get nothing useful. But this is a future. It's a promise. It will get you results once the task is finished. Then you must use callback. So this way I add a callback. Here this way you can check whether we get the meaningful results. If not, you can say sorry. I cannot give you the Gandhi squad. So this is the way how you handle the error in the async.io code. Okay, so that's it. I'm thanking you for listening to me, and I want to thank to one of the Python core developers, Sendal Kumaran, who helped me polish this talk. And I hope you gain something useful from this talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Sky. Questions?
Hey, thank you for the interesting talk. I want to check, can we add tasks while the tasks are being executed? Like, we start with three tasks, and then can we add one more while the task is running, if you have the reference to the object?
You mean, can I add the task?
Yes.
While executing another task?
Yes. So let's say start with three tasks and then I add a couple more. Is it possible?
So you mean you want to create the task while the event loop is running?
Yes.
Of course you can.
Okay. Thank you.
Right? Is there a similar limitation with async.io that the loop that you started, once it stops, you cannot start it again?
Well, you can restart the event loop if you stop it, but you cannot restart the event loop if you close it. So there's a stop method, there's a close method. The close method is the final. It's dead.
Yeah, in your server example, you're using both yield and return inside a function.
I'm sorry again?
Yeah, in your previous example that you were using, you had a get output function which had yield from and return.
I'm sorry, I don't get it.
Yeah, so I was asking. I mean, where does it return towards?
If there's a yield as well as return, what is actually being returned?
Oh, you mean it depends on the coroutine itself. So if you
it's kind of the same of the yield case. It just return the what you want, whatever you want to return. Okay, I don't get it, but let me talk to you after this talk. Okay.
One more question. Is there a context manager that Monkey patches all the default functions to use the async IO functions?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.